This is the new 2021 Kia Sorento, and it is Kia's other midsize SUV. Over the last year and a half, the Kia Telluride has been hugely popular as Kia's midsize three-row family SUV. But if you're looking for a more affordable alternative, Kia also has the Sorento, which has been redesigned for the 2021 model year with some muscular, brawny, Telluride-like design cues. Before I get started, be sure to check out Cars and Bids, which is my enthusiast car auction website with an amazing selection of cool cars from the modern era. We've had some amazing sales recently, including this 2003 Lexus LX470, which sold for $21,500, this Lincoln Town Car with only 8,000 original miles that sold for $12,400, and this Dodge Challenger SRT Hellcat with a manual transmission that sold for $44,000. If you're looking to sell your cool enthusiast car from the modern era, the 1980s and up, Cars and Bids is the place to do it. We have an amazing selection and daily auctions. Check it out at carsandbids.com. So let's talk Sorento. Kia positions the Sorento to compete in the smaller, more affordable end of the midsize SUV segment against rivals like the Hyundai Santa Fe, the Ford Edge, the Chevy Blazer, the Subaru Outback, and kind of the Jeep Grand Cherokee. One big advantage the Sorento has is three-row seating, which isn't offered by most competitors in this segment. Of course, Kia already has an SUV with three-row seating, the Telluride, which I mentioned earlier, but the Sorento is smaller and cheaper. The Sorento starts around $28,000, while the Telluride starts around $33,000. Think of the Sorento as like the Ford Edge, while the Telluride is larger, it's like the Ford Explorer. But Kia sees why the Telluride has been so popular, in part because of its muscular, brawny, boxy styling. So the redesigned 2021 Sorento gets some Telluride-inspired styling with a more muscular look compared to the old Sorento. It also has some appealing powertrains. You can get a turbo four-cylinder with about 280 horsepower or a hybrid engine that gets around 37 miles per gallon. And there's also a base engine with about 190 horsepower. And today, I'm going to show you what else it has. First, I'm going to take you on a tour of the new Sorento and show you all the quirks and features of the latest Kia SUV. Then I'm gonna get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'll give it a DOUGSCORE. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of the new Sorento with the styling, and specifically how boxy and muscular it is. You can especially see this in the taillights and back, these sort of rectangles, and just the general rear end styling, a lot boxier, brawnier than the outgoing Sorento. Again, this is borrowed from the Telluride, which is frankly just a pretty standard midsize SUV, but its off-roady looking styling has made it a huge hit with people who want their family SUV to seem a bit more capable, so they've translated that to the Sorento as well. Now, one other thing you get back here is this, which is like a weird fin that goes into the rear side window. Not sure what it's doing there, but it is there, a little styling component in the new Sorento. Now, next up, moving up front in the new Sorento, you can see the design up here isn't as boxy and brawny and square as it is in back. Instead, more curvy up here, like you'd expect from kind of a traditional crossover look. But you do have a more aggressive grille design up here than in prior Sorentos or most other crossovers. It's large and aggressive, and it looks like it can just take a bite out of you. Again, trying to make this seem brawnier and bulkier to play off the success of the Telluride. And next up, another interesting item on the outside. Right here, you have a badge that says X-Line, which is apparently some trim package that makes the new Sorento look cooler than the ones without the X-Line. Lexus has F-Sport, Audi has S-Line, and I guess Kia now has X line. The Koreans remain the leaders in badging that nobody really seems to care about. X line right here. In the back, next to the trim level, it says TGDI. No one knows what that means. I know, it means turbocharged gasoline direct injection, but nobody sitting behind this car at a stoplight sees that badge and says, oh, this has TGDI. I have to run to the Kia dealer and buy a new Sorento. It's just a waste of money for a badge. And then under the hood, it says on the engine cover, Smart Stream G. No one knows what that means who buys this car. It makes no sense to waste the time and effort and money to put it there, as if some proud Sorento owner is gonna pop the hood and point to that and say, yeah, I got Smart Stream G. None of that Smart Stream F for me, you know? Oh, no. We're way beyond that. But anyway, next I'm moving inside the Sorento. I'm gonna start in the back seats, because if you're looking for a family SUV, a good back seat situation is high on your list of priorities, and this car offers a good back seat situation. You can see this Sorento has captain's chairs back here, so two individual rear seats, which has become very popular recently. And you can also see that on the side of the captain's chairs, there's this little netting where you can store some stuff if you have a small item you want to place here while you're being driven along. Now, the back seats don't really have anything special or interesting to cover back here, although I do like the rather innovative situation with the charge ports. You have two charge ports in the regular spot in the center on the back of the front center console where you'd expect, but you also have charge ports on the backs of the front seats. You can see right here and over here. So that gives you extra charge ports for rear seat passengers to charge their devices, and they're in a more accessible spot than all the way down at the floor. But probably the best thing about the second row is just how easy it is to access the third row. Now, a lot of kids trying to get into the third row in this car will just open the door, walk in, walk between the captain's chairs, and then enter the third row that way. But if you want to fold the seat down for easier third row access, it's an incredibly easy process. There's just a little button on the side of the seat. You push it, and then you can see the seat folds forward. One button, you don't move anything, lift anything, no levers or latches. It all does it on its own. It really is incredibly simple, probably the easiest of any car in the entire car industry to get into the third row. It's also rather easy to simply fold down the second row seat entirely. You can see on the side of the second row seat, there's a little latch. You just pull that and then the seat back folds down and then the seat is down. So that's if you want to maximize your cargo volume and want a huge flat floor back here. Just pull that latch, the seat's down. It's just that simple. But anyway, next up, let's talk about the third row seat in the Sorento. Starting with the most obvious thing, it is small back here. The third row seat in the Telluride isn't exactly huge, and that's a midsize SUV. This is an even smaller midsize SUV, also with a third row, and there's just not all that much space. You don't have a lot of legroom, but especially you don't have a lot of headroom. And when you're sitting in this third row seat, you can start to see why a lot of other small midsize SUVs don't offer a third row at all, because there's just not a lot of space. But it's back here for small children, for short trips, and it can add some usefulness and practicality if you want a third row, but you don't want a big vehicle, which is typically what you have to get in order to get a big third row. But with that said, if you are a third row passenger in the new Sorento, it's not a total penalty box back here. There is some good stuff. For instance, you have power ports on each side. So one over on the driver's side, third row, and one on the passenger side, two individual power ports, which most three row vehicles don't have. I also like the fact that you have individual cup holders, again, one on each side. And there's this little storage compartment where you can put a tablet or a phone. So if kids are back here playing with the tablet on a long road trip, they have a place to stow it if they want to take a nap or do something else. So there's some good stuff back here, just not good for adults or for long trips. It is a pretty small area, and if you're going to be using the third row a lot, you probably want a bigger vehicle. But anyway, since we're talking third row, now it's time to talk cargo area. For one thing, accessing the cargo area is kind of weird. In most vehicles, the little trunk popper is back here above the license plate, but you can see I'm touching it and it doesn't open. That's because in the Sorento, it's actually hidden down here in this little panel you wouldn't really notice except for the fact that it contains the cargo area popper. So you press it and then the lift gate opens up and you can see the cargo area. And you can also see that it is small back here. With the third row in place, you don't have basically any cargo room at all. That's no real surprise, given that this is a smaller midsize SUV. It's already stretching at having three rows at all. And so if you have the third row in place, you're just not gonna get that much space. You do, however, have a nice underfloor storage component back here. So if the third row's in place, you have a little bit more storage than you might think, but not all that much. But if you want more cargo space back here, folding down the third row is incredibly easy. You don't just have a button to fold it down like you could in the top versions of the Telluride. Instead, you have this little strap, but it's very easy, very quick. You just pull on the strap, push on the seat, and then it's down, and there's your cargo area now fully expanded with the third row gone and folded all the way down. Very simple. And getting it back up is, of course, just as simple. You just pull on the same little strap, and the third row comes right back up, and that's all you gotta do to move the third row. Not as luxurious as having a button, but it is a lot quicker, it's worth noting. Now, with that said, one other item worth noting back here. If you wanna make the cargo area completely flat and fold down both the third row and the second row, you fold down the third row like I showed you, and then you will see those little buttons over on the passenger side of the cargo area that say second, L, and R. You push those, and the second row seats will completely fold down flat as well. So, you don't actually have to go over to each individual second row seat to fold them down. If you want to put all the seats down, you can do it from back here. Worth noting though, those buttons don't put the second row seats back up. So once you've put them down, you have to go around to the seats and actually put them back in place. But you can fold all the seats down from the cargo area if you're trying to load something huge back here and you don't have to use your back seats for anything. But anyway, next up to close the tailgate, you press a little button under the tailgate like basically every other car, and the tailgate automatically folds down like basically every other car. One thing I like back here is the fact that there is no exposed rear wiper. Most SUVs have a wiper just sitting here, obviously to wipe the rear windshield, but the Sorento doesn't. Instead, they've hidden it under this rear spoiler back here, so it's out of the way, and it just looks better and it looks cleaner in back. But the drawback to that is, because of where they have to put the wiper for that to actually happen, you can see when it's wiping, it doesn't really cover that much of the rear window. It maybe gets half of it, or maybe a little bit more than half. If you had the wiper down on the bottom, it could probably do more window, but up at the top, not as functional, but it does look better. It's a little trade-off. And next up, we move on to the front seats of the new Sorento, where there are some notable quirks and features, starting with the blind spot turn signal camera. Check this out. You put the turn signal on while you're driving, and a little camera appears in the gauge cluster, letting you know what's in your blind spot, which is tremendously useful, obviously, if you're trying to make a lane change. You put the turn signal on the other direction, and the other side blind spot camera shows up, again, showing exactly what's in your blind spot. Just a tremendously exciting and cool way to do it. Now, I've shown this feature before in several new Hyundai and Kia models, but usually in luxury models like Genesis or the Kia K900. This is the first time I've seen it put in a mid-priced, affordable family SUV, and I think it's fantastic. This is a great safety feature, and I really hope it becomes an industry standard across all cars before too long. Right now, it's trickling into all of the new Hyundais and Kias. Next up, here's an interesting quirk in this car, the climate vents. You can see they look like fairly normal climate vents, except below them, they have an additional smaller vent that you can move around. Each climate vent has this, the one on the driver's side, the two in the middle, the one on the passenger side. They all have sort of a large upper vent and then a lower, smaller vent, which is kind of cool. The large upper vent blows in your face, on your chest where you might want it, but then the lower vent also blows down your knees or your legs, where you also might want air, and that is a pretty cool touch. Sort of split climate vents that allow the air to flow to different parts of your body. Never really seen that before, but it's a neat idea. Next up, moving into the center console, you can see prominently in here, there's a dial that allows you to change between the different drive modes, and there are five different modes, one of which is called Smart, which I guess basically adapts to your driving style using the vehicle's intelligence to give you the responsiveness and pedal feel or steering that you want based on how you're driving. Now, the cool thing here is when you turn this dial to go between the modes, the gauge cluster reacts, and you can see all of the different sort of animations that play as you go into each drive mode. Undoubtedly, the coolest one is you go into sport mode, and then this happens. It's kind of a nice little display, but each one gives you a different animation to go along with each drive mode. Now, speaking of the gauge cluster, full screen in this this car, although not all that configurable, but it does have one feature I absolutely love. When you adjust the position of the headlights on the turn signal stalk, you can see you're changing it on the stalk, but it also shows what position you've selected in the gauge cluster itself. It's a great feature. It means you don't actually have to look at the signal stalk to see where the headlights are. You can just look in the gauge cluster where it's displayed more prominently and more conveniently. This is the same deal with the wipers. When you adjust the wiper stalk, it also shows where you've adjusted it to in the gauge cluster. And the benefit here is that means you won't be trying to figure out, is it off or just on low intermittent? Is it going to wipe again? You look in the gauge cluster when you're adjusting it and you'll see easily. That's a great idea, sort of that redundancy there to make it clearer exactly where you've put those items. And next up, we move on to the climate controls, which are in the center control stack, and they're kind of strange. It's a weird mix between buttons and switches, and then also capacitive touch buttons for the fan speed control and a few others in the center, as you can see. The switches, though, are the thing that I like the least. They're for the temperature of the climate control, and it's quite tedious. If you want to go from cold to hot, you have to tap, 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 tap up a million times, and it's just annoying. I prefer cars that have like a slider or even a dial, but a switch where each tap is an individual temperature change, it can take a while to go from cold to hot. But anyway, next we move on to the infotainment system itself. This is the infotainment screen. Frankly, it's a bit small compared to a lot of newer cars I'm getting in with larger and larger screens, but it's there. It's also a little bit far away for the driver and passenger to reach since it's mounted kind of far back on the top of the dashboard. But no real drawback there, just minor complaints. And the screen itself, very responsive, very easy to use. And it has a couple of Hyundai and Kia quirks that I've shown you before, like sounds of nature, where you can actually listen to pre-programmed nature sounds while you drive. You also have a feature called driver talk. You press this and then it projects your voice using a microphone into the rear speakers in the third row, so you don't have to turn around and yell to your kids. You can just talk to them easily with your microphone. You also have a feature called quiet mode. You press that and it only plays music through the front speakers, and even then at a limited volume. So you're driving on a family road trip, your kids have fallen asleep in the back, you can still listen to music without waking them up. I have demonstrated these features in other Hyundai and Kia reviews in more depth, and I will link those in the description below so you can check out how they work and so you can listen to some sounds of nature. And finally, we move under the hood where you can see the SmartStream G. Whatever that means. This engine, though, has 280 horsepower, 310 pound-feet of torque. Those are healthy numbers, but this is only a four-cylinder. It's a turbo four-cylinder. In fact, the Sorento is not offered with a V6. Like I said, the base engine, around 190 horsepower. That's going to be pretty mediocre to drive, I suspect. This one, 280, pretty good. And then there's also a hybrid version. That'll have about 230 horsepower, and it'll get 37 miles per gallon in combined city and highway driving, which is an excellent figure for a vehicle this size. Also worth noting, hybrid pricing is out, and the hybrid is only about $2,000 more than a comparable gas-powered Sorento. So you will make back that pricing difference in not that long if you get the Sorento hybrid, especially if you drive a lot. That Sorento hybrid is pretty appealing if you're not looking for the big, powerful 280 horsepower SmartStream G. And so, those are the quirks and features of the new 2021 Kia Sorento. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the Sorento. Now, the first thing I've noticed when I've been driving this is it just kind of drives like a crossover. You know, and I feel this way about the Telluride too. Kia likes the fact that, oh, it's the brawny, muscular, go-anywhere crossover. Well, no, it's not. It's just a crossover. It just happens to have muscular styling, and people have really been drawn to that. But it's a normal crossover. It just kind of looks, you know, bulkier than the others. And they've tried to do that a little bit here, but once again, it just ultimately is a relatively standard crossover. Now, this one doesn't quite look as capable, I think because they didn't want to go too far with the capable styling and steal some sales away from the Telluride, which is more expensive. There's probably more profit in the Telluride, so they wanted to be a little bit cautious with that. But this still does have some of the bulky look, but not really the bulky driving experience. It just drives like basically any other crossover. One interesting difference is not related to the capability feel of it, but actually the transmission. This is like some sort of dual clutch situation. Most people who drive this car will never need to know or care about it, except for the fact that it's very smooth. Gear changers are really smooth. You don't feel them at all. You can hear them because this is a mid-price Kia, and so you get a little bit more engine noise in here, so you can hear the gear changes, but they're very, very smooth. With that said, you know, whatever transmission, dual clutch, I don't remember the thing about it. It doesn't matter. The question is, will it be reliable? We'll find that out, I guess, in time. Otherwise, in terms of the driving experience of this car, you know, like all crossovers I review, not really that interesting or exceptional or unusual in any way. It drives like the crossover that it is. You're sitting in it and it feels reasonably nice to drive, reasonably quiet, but not too nice, not too quiet. Certainly doesn't handle sportily. And you're not insulated like a luxury vehicle you might be. One thing that is worth mentioning, the acceleration with this powertrain, you know, I assumed 280 horsepower, 310 pound-feet of torque, that it would be pretty fast, actually. It would feel pretty quick. It doesn't really. It feels fine. Certainly more power than you need in most situations, so it's totally adept at getting up to highway speeds and all that. But it's not like it makes it feel fast or sporty or really exciting. Ultimately, to me, you know, the real benefit of this car comes in the fact that it's a practical vehicle. I think the fact that it's a three-row seat SUV at this price point is unusual, and that will probably draw in most of the buyers. This particular Sorento is equipped to like $44,000. Unlikely they're going to sell many like this. To me, the Sorento's biggest selling point is relatively low pricing for a third row. And if you want to spend big money and get three rows, you're going to probably want the Telluride. You get more space, you get the cool styling, and it's just a better vehicle, better insulated, more tech, more stuff, that sort of thing. But that's not to say this is bad. You know, this kind of smaller midsize SUV segment, there are some not great vehicles in it. The Chevy Blazer is not really all that good. The Jeep Cherokee has gotten old. It's a little smaller, but it's around the same size. The Hyundai Santa Fe is not tremendously appealing. Even the Ford Edge, none of these cars are like really jump out at you as very exciting or appealing. Automakers have really put a lot more effort into the bigger three-row vehicles like the new Explorer, like the Telluride, Subaru Ascent, that sort of thing. And so this car is actually, for this segment, is pretty good. It's just that the segment is not generally all that appealing. Most people who want a family SUV, they're willing to spend a little bit more, get a three row, a larger car like the Telluride or the Explorer, and they get a better vehicle. And so automakers have put more effort into that. And so that's the 2021 Kia Sorento. This is no Telluride. It's not as big, it's not as muscular, it doesn't have the look. But if you like the Telluride and you want something more affordable, or you just want something smaller, this is an excellent alternative. It has great technology, great powertrains, and it's an excellent midsize SUV. And now it's time to give the new Sorento a DOUGSCORE. Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the Sorento looks fine, normal, nothing special, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Acceleration is in the low 7-second range, even with the top engine, and it gets a 1 out of 10. Handling is average, as expected for a vehicle like this, and it gets a 3 out of 10. Fun factor is basically zero. This isn't about fun, and it doesn't offer much enjoyment, and it gets a 1 out of 10. Cool factor is also low. It's not cool, but that's by design, and it gets a 1 out of 10 for a total weekend score of 11 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. The Sorento is nicely equipped, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Comfort is great, not amazing, but nice enough, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Quality is good, Kia reliability is nice, the excellent warranty is a big deal, while interior quality is good, but not great, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Practicality is good, though it's not quite as large as some three-row rivals, which hampers things a bit, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Finally, value, and it's a nice enough one. It offers a lot, and pricing is reasonable, and it gets a 7 out of 10 for a total daily score of 36 out of 50. Add it up, and the DOUGSCORE is 47 out of 100, which places it here against other relevant crossovers. The Sorento does okay. It's not as high-tech as some or as roomy as others. Where it shines is providing a three-row crossover with decent tech at a reasonable price. It's not the best in this segment in terms of tech or interior space or power, but it's a compelling value, especially against the pricey and difficult-to-find Telluride.